one of the first photos of young Ruderman.
Look at the state of that. I broke my hand, didn't I? Then I shattered my thumb. So I broke my thumb on Jordan's head, and then I had to have two K-wires put in it. But I fractured the top of my shin and snapped my ACL. What else did I do? Oh, my neck. I had a disc replacement in my neck.
And walking through the streets, Johnny just yelled out and said, "Oh, I'll give you $500 if you win by knockout tonight." And I just giggled because it's not as common to hear that girls win by knockout. Second round knockout. I was like, holy goodness, I did it. At that point, I didn't think about the fact that Donnie had offered $500
for the knockout. He would have been running up somewhere.
I was just like jumping into Andy's arms. I was like, oh my goodness.
Well, this one in particular was stacked. Not anything to do with me, but Si has a funny story where he said he messaged me. I said, I hope you're working on your clinch, and told him that I'd been wrestling, and he laughed, and I got destroyed in the clinch. Wrestling and the clinch are a different thing, apparently.
The Giorgio Petrosian and the Petr Morakot rematch.
Yeah.
That's the first time ever I nearly vomited before an event. I was so nervous. Everyone was just like, hey, you're the man, huh? You got that out. Leading up that week, I really didn't want to think about it, and I was doing a good job here. But once I went over to, we were in Malaysia, everyone was just like, hey, you got the big one, yeah, hey.
I mean, lucky you've been stuck with me in isolation. We don't usually train together a lot. Before comps, if he's also not prepping for comps, he definitely steps up and helps me out a little bit and pretends to be a small girl. And you know, but he's a lightweight, like he's a 78, 77 kilo male. I'm like a light feather female. So we're not each other's best training partners. He has to go extremely light not to hurt me, which changes the jiu-jitsu so much. It's not really realistic.
It doesn't matter how technical, how, you know, vicious, strong, whatever, like, you know, I'll look at that guy on pads, man. It doesn't mean shit, you know what I mean? Everything has to do, and I think the Thais obviously refer to it as heart as well, but like, I just lost it. It was not right after that fight, and the passion and, you know, the excitement that I got from, like, when I used to fight, I get that by coaching. And that makes me happy.
By the time it gets to this stage, like what we can see in the photo here, I like to think I've done everything that I can do. You know, we've done all the preparation, we've done all the training, counted for every kind of possibility, for everything that could go wrong. And then you feel, you know, you feel confident. You feel confident, but you can't be too confident. You're just confident enough that you've done everything you can, but you're still ready for whatever else has to be done.
Like, you know, you kind of like have the ideas and you talk to your coach, but what happens when you get an eight count, you know, like you're just playing these scenarios out in the gym, talking about it, but when it actually happens, and I remember standing out and really clearly, I could hear a lot of screaming, like from the corners screaming, but really clearly I could hear Eddie scream at Brooke, and he was like, she's done, she's finished, like finish her, like knock her out, finish her now. And I remember just thinking, like, oh my God, like I wonder how bad I look right now, like am I like, looking like I'm really bad in that state where it's like the next exchange I'm going to be out, or is just saying that to like get her like fired up a little bit more.
The change room is my favorite place at a fight show.
Mine too.
If most people look back to Evolution, like I put on $250,000-$260,000 shows, and I spent most of the time out the back in the dressing room. Whenever I go to any show, I'm usually out the back because that's where the real action is. That's where, you know, like other than the actual fighting in the ring, everything else happens out the back.
I took this loss pretty hard because I knew it was going to be my last fight. I didn't get my fairy tale ending. It was probably an ending that you would like to erase from your memory. I feel that was the right time in my life to stop. You know, I'd set myself a goal to get as far as I could before I was 30, and then after 30, I would stop.
The thing I read years ago that was like about fathers and sons, and saying that one of the nicest things you can tell your kids is, I love watching you play. For a lot of these guys, the guys that I have on Rebellion, whether they win or lose, by and large, I love watching them fight, and I just want them to know that. So many fighters after they lose say, I'm so sorry, I hope I didn't disappoint you, and I'm like, Dude, what are you talking about? The fight is, you were part of that fight. You might have won, you might have lost. I love watching you fight, like, and I do. And if I didn't, I wouldn't put him on.
Yeah, look, man, that's something I'll never forget. It was an amazing experience, you know, in Marvel and in my hometown, and, you know, being such a big underdog, you know, Mucky coming off the contender series and looking like a beast. And with me, as you pointed out, I've always had to come back against adversity a lot of times. So that never bothered me too much. And I had great support from the corner, and it was just an amazing experience. As you can see, when my name got read out as the winner, it was an extremely emotional time.
Fight. No, there's a skill acquisition part, like, you know, like being skilled enough to jump in there and all that. That's important. But I think there is a certain thing with understanding what guys are going through in their head before walking out. There is a really important part of it. And that was part of me doing this was, like, I sort of was almost fighting still to develop more as a coach, if that makes sense. So that was probably, you know, even following through, like, on all the weight cut protocols and doing all those sorts of things that I'm like, a whole range of different things that I was sort of using myself as a test dummy.
You can't go out there saying, I'm going to strike this guy and knock him out, because he might be a great striker. You can't say, I'm going to take him down and submit him, because he might be a high-level jiu-jitsu guy. So you had to sort of just see where the fight went and feel it out. And that translates still to today. Like I said, I mean, my fights now, I could be fighting, you know, a good striker in the UFC. It's so unpredictable, you don't know what's going to happen. And this sort of event taught me that exactly. So there was one time I had 3 fights in one day. My old man, he said, I want you to fight this guy. And he points at the guy. And I was like, you can look at, I was like 65 kilos back then. And he points at this guy, he's about 90 kilos and looks like a bodybuilder. I said, I'm not fighting him, there's no chance. But he goes, get in that ring and fight him. I was like, oh, my dad says something, you got to do it. So I was like, all right. So I hopped in and I fought the guy. And I ended up TKOing him in, like, I think it was maybe like a minute.
A novice guy, hadn't done a corner before, had the first time going into state with someone. He called Azza and said, Azza, man, what do I do? Azza goes, whatever the fighter wants, that is what you do. So as a trainer, even if you're not involved in their fight camp or their normal training or whatever, when you're all going away, you just do whatever they want.
I hope they know it, and I'll verbalize it now that, you know, trainers like Peasy, Darren, you know, they're guys that I looked up to as a fighter growing up. And then as a young gym owner, they're the guys that I looked at with all their fighters and like aspired to be, you know, to say, oh yeah, I'd love to like jump in a corner with you or something like that. It really means to me, like that respect from my peers means a lot to me, you know. Obviously, we're on the other corner, it's different. But when they say that they would want to be a part of your team and corner guys together, going to war together, it really means a lot.
There's always been the doubt how legitimate movie stars that do martial arts are. There was a lot of conjecture around Stephen before that seminar. In my position, you know, I was like, man, this guy, if he tries to do something, I'm going to try and have a crack, you know. Yeah. Like, I'm not going to let myself be broken down either. But what I found and what transpired was I met a legitimate martial artist. You know, he's a bit quirky and he's got his own way, but half the people I know are a little bit quirky. But when I saw him flip people with my own eyes, like literally, you know, wrist lock them and turn them, because if they didn't roll with his lock, he would have popped their elbow, he would have popped their shoulder. It was inevitable that they would have become injured.
During that 6-second break to recover, so hopefully by 30 seconds into the round, you've got your breath back, your heart slow down, and then you can concentrate on what your trainer's saying to you, so it sinks in more, so it doesn't just go in one ear and out the other. So you're going to rely on your cornerman to be your eyes, what they can see, what you can't, while you're competing.
Yep.
So do what they say. And then it all depends what it is as well. I remember one of the boys, it was the 5th round of one of my fights, he goes, all right, this round, last round, just go out there and just throw double kicks. It's like, mate, it's the 5th round, I'm rather tired. I don't think I'll be doing any double kicks at all.
I'm going to tell you, know what, how long have we got? Can I tell you this whole
story? As long as you want, mate.
Get a phone call from Tarek Solak. I want to come in, I want to take you out for dinner. I want to meet you. He says, I hear that some people like you and some people don't like you. I said, oh, okay. I want to put your name in life. I want to take you around the world. I said, you want to meet at McDonald's on the Western Highway? He said, okay, we'll meet there. He comes in and he shouted me McChicken meal.
Yeah, being backstage, I'm absolutely terrified of needles. Absolutely terrified. So I think this was at
Prestige.
Prestige, that's the one, yes. When you're in the backstage and you're about to walk out, that's when everything else fades away.
It's that calm before the storm.
And it's exactly, and you're like, it's no longer about my trainers, it's no longer about who's here to support me. It's about the guy that's going to be in front of me in the next 10 minutes. Yeah. And for you, you capture that moment. Like, there's a photo of Som, there's a photo of Alex, there's a photo of Kwan just sitting in the back room on the chairs, and they're not even looking at the camera, they're even looking at the boy. They're just sitting there and they're thinking,